disease. Of course, this is, I think, the fourth case of Heteromatous polyposis which we have got in this hospital. The two of them were familial with known family histories, and two of them were spontaneous. One of them had presented with obstruction. And of course, two of them, one at the age of 18 and one at the age of 45, the one who had presented with obstruction, they actually came with malignancies. So that is that. You know, about 75% of them have a family history, and about 25% of them actually have polyposis coli as a result of spontaneous mutations. And in fact, that is one of the reasons why this disease is still so much in existence, because a lot of these patients actually could die before they they procreate. But 25% of them have spontaneous mutations. So there are 25% of patients will be without a family history. However, this is a disease with about 100% penetrance, as he mentioned. It is autosomal dominant with 100% penetrance. So if this girl gets married and has children, then there is almost 100% chance that her children will be having this heteromatous coli.
So marital counseling is also required?
Yes, obviously it is required. And there are two things to it. So sometimes they may escape. And there are two things we need to do: the colonoscopic screening from the age of 10 to 12. And also, what is very important is we can do the ophthalmological examination. Because even when these polyps are not there, or they come much later, say about the age of 17, 18 or whatever, you can get this congenital hypertrophy of the retinal pigment epithelium. And if a patient has this, then it is almost certain that this is a patient who is going to develop polyps in the future. And they can be monitored much more, they can be screened much more aggressively, because that is a kind of surrogate marker for this. The eye actually doesn't create any problems. He can have normal vision for the rest of his life, but it is a surrogate marker, because if this congenital hypertrophy of the retinal pigment epithelium is present, these children are bound to develop polyposis coli in the future. And this, once this condition develops, it has an almost 100% chance of turning malignant. So the malignancy conversion rate is 100%. So they have to be treated. Now, what is the problem with the treatment? The problem with the treatment is that you obviously are removing the entire colon and rectum. And therefore, these patients can have problems of diarrhea, incontinence, etc. So one of the kind of compromise measures is, if the rectum is not fully loaded, carpeted, but unfortunately in all the four cases that we got, the rectum was carpeted with polyps. You can preserve the polyps in the rectum, maybe snare them off if there are few in number, and then you can give those drugs like Sulindac and others, which may, and keep them under regular follow-up, because then the quality of life of the patient tends to be much better. But if the rectum is carpeted, like it was in this case, and in fact all the three cases of ours which we have treated, we have no option but to remove the entire rectum. And in this case, we had just about 2.5 centimeters of the anal canal. I was in fact fearing a lot more of diarrhea and incontinence, but to my relatively pleasant surprise, the patient is quite satisfied. She's just having about three, four motions a day. Normally at this stage, one should expect about 7 to 8 motions a day, if not more. And continence is also fairly okay. Now, continence goes for two reasons. One is because the sphincter goes. Number two, we try to preserve the sphincter, you know, because unlike malignancy, if it would have turned malignant, the operation is different. Unlike malignancy, where we go very far from the tumor, far from the rectum, destroying the sphincter and nerves, here we tend to stick to the rectum, we tend to hug the colon and the rectum. We don't take lymph nodes and all that. So you know, that's not an issue. So we tend to stick close to the rectum, we don't do those total mesorectal excisions, etc. But having so the sphincteric complex, we try to preserve as much as possible. But continence is not dependent only on the sphincter. Continence is also dependent on healthy sensory rectal mucosa, which is all taken off. So that is another issue. And secondly, you must understand that the nature of the stool is quite liquid, because it is just the ileal contents which actually come out. So the nature of the stool is liquid. We take away this sensory mucosa, and a part of the sphincter obviously gets destroyed. But luckily, in this case, the patient is happy. I think her continence and the number of stools that she's passing per day is quite satisfactory, even in this early stage, and it is generally expected to improve with time. And we have removed the entire rectum. It's, in fact, possibly even the upper part of the anal canal. Just for the technical reason, I tried to save a bit more of the rectum, you know, when I put in my first stapler into the pelvis, and I removed a few polyps. But when I did a PR after that, only 6 centimeters of the rectum was left. but there was still plenty of polish there. So I, in fact, I did another stapling very low down, just about 2.5 centimeters from the anal valve. This anastomosis cannot be possible without the help of a circular staple, but normally people would do a loop, a diverting loop ileostomy for 3 months. So I think 90%, 95% of people would always do a loop diverting ileostomy. Well, you can say we should have also done it, but somehow I was quite happy with the anastomosis. The donuts were all right. We did a leak test. Everything was okay. I'm not generally very much in favor of doing diverting ileostomies and colostomies, though I would agree that in this case, 90% of surgeons all over the world would do it. We didn't do it. We've got away with it. It's done well. But, and that is it. The patient has been discharged in due course without any complications.
So they're very difficult subject.
It is a long surgery, it is a complicated surgery, but what is important is that it's not just the technical difficulty which is involved, but well, we require a lot of anesthesia support also,
yes,
for the long,
yes,
duration.
Yes.
And but more than that, you know, it is the quality of life that we have to actually monitor and understand.
Any dietary advice, special dietary advice?
You know, to begin with, since it is the ileal contents which are directly coming out into the rectum, there is about 1500 cc of effluent every day. Now, in due course of time, we have to, this reduces to about 500 milliliters per day in about 1 year's time. So that is how it's nature's adaptation. We can give little low residue diets, but what is actually important, that doesn't help much. What is actually important is trying to monitor the electrolyte levels. These patients need to drink more water. These patients require a little more sodium and potassium in their diets. Even if the serum sodium potassium levels are normal, we should ideally be measuring their urinary electrolytes, because the total body electrolytes tend to be a little less, and therefore we need to compensate them. Otherwise, they can suffer from what is called chronic dehydration. So basically, we need to give them advice of taking adequate fluids, little more of sodium and potassium, regardless of what their serum electrolytes may be, because their total body electrolytes tend to be less, and we need to measure the urinary electrolytes in order to see that and give them a little more of electrolytes. Otherwise, they adjust pretty well. And if this girl is doing so well, she's so happy, her parents, both herself and her parents, are so happy, within 1 month of surgery, it is likely that she is going to improve from here on.
Both of the parents don't have this familial polyposis.
No. This is possibly a case of spontaneous mutation.
Any follow-up is required with the ileum gets involved or not in future?
See, an upper GI endoscopy is generally recommended, because sometimes these are associated with... It has been done, and it will be followed up. Yes, follow-up upper GI endoscopies are done, because sometimes there are upper GI polyps, particularly periampullary carcinomas may also be associated with it. But that chance is not, that's about 5-10% chance. So we need to keep doing a regular, maybe an upper GI endoscopy every, 3 years or so. But